started.
Yeah, we used last year's. Anyone have an X they'd like to throw out there? Or that. Did anyone else get the 2.28 times 10 to the negative fourth? Kind of, it may depend on what you did up here. I don't know if you went with 1.32 or 1.318. And I may have gone with 1.32, so that could also be a difference. No, I went with 1.38 or 1.8. No, either way. Anybody do a percent yet? Trust yourself. Come on, Grace, trust yourself. I would. Because since that's the smallest one, if it's negligible to that, it's negligible to the other one. No, 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 no. Because that's zero. Okay, multiply it by two. I don't care. Because what's it come out to be?
Well, it's multiplied by 0.099.
Yeah, 0.099. If you don't multiply it by two, it comes out to by 0.05. Percent. You did something weird with your... Yep. Okay, so anyway, we're incredibly less than 5%. Okay? If you multiply 2, it comes out to like a little bit less than 0.1%. We're cool. We're good, right? It's negligible. So now it just comes down for calculating the equilibrium concentrations. This is a piece. You've done all this wonderful work. You've done all this great manipulation of information, and then a lot of times students will forget to actually answer. The question is, what is the concentration of all species at the end? So, coming over here, we're going to take our 1.318 plus 2.28 times 10 to the negative 4th. Obviously, this is 2.28 times 10 to the negative 4th. And this is 0.464 minus 2 times 2.28 times 10 to the negative 4th. Whatever that comes out to be. I think most of you will find that these two quantities end up being incredibly negligible and ends up being exactly the same. And we end up with 2.28 times 10 to the negative 4th. Once you guys get that all sorted out, I want to review everything that happened in that problem. Okay. Let's talk about the stuff that was what you're going to run into and the stuff that was atypical about that question. This piece was atypical. You're not always going to run into a scenario where you're going to have to shift everything over to one side or the other. But was everyone comfortable with the thinking process there? No one took me up on my challenge today. Every once in a while I get somebody ambitious enough to do that. Anyway, that is very atypical. That's probably not going to come up too much in your life, but hey, this is what you can do if you need to, okay? What was the other atypical thing? I thought there was something else. No, that was about it. Everything else is pretty good. Yes.
So, do we not do
Because we didn't shift everything over. Okay, in this case, since we were moving everything over, turned out we did have a limiting reactant. Now, if this had ended up being 0.232 for both of them, no big deal. It just ends up being 0.464 over there. Is that good? And the other thing that ended up happening here, which is another reason why I like this question, is we ended up solving for one of the reactants where we had the other one. Does that make any sense? Because it's just like stoichiometry problems. You can solve for any of these pieces if you know the rest of them. Okay. Well, you've now seen large, you've seen small. Now we have to do the intermediate, and there's actually two stories that go with this one. So, should be part C, is that right? I'm just chuckling to myself because I know what's going to be left on the board after you guys leave and what my next group's going to come in and see. And every year they just look at it and they go, it's going to be impressive. All right, here we go. Was that a good idea to, yeah. All right, here we go. Now, this next question is, parts of it are very typical of what we're going to be doing after we get out of chapter 15. The first this reaction is going to be an acid base or an acid dissociation. This is what the primarily most of our calculations in 16 and 17 are going to be. So we're going to take some sulfurous acid. In equilibrium. Now, you guys may remember, hopefully from chapter 4, acid dissociations. Okay, do you remember the distinction between weak acids and strong acids? Does anyone vaguely remember that we discussed that? I had you memorize a number of strong acids. Does anyone happen to recall what those were? Hydrofluoric is not one of them. HCl. Now you're on a roll. Keep going. HCl, HBr, HI are all strong acids. That's three. Yeah, we're going to get to that. Sulfuric acid for one of the hydrogens. There is no such thing. You're pretty good at this. Hexahedral. Sorry. I didn't say your name, so it's okay. Nitric, remember nitric? And perchloric, HClO4. Those five are the strong acids, okay? Those are the ones that completely dissociate. It's a non-equilibrium thing. One arrow, one direction for the arrow, okay? Every other acid is a weak acid. Now, back then, I tried to explain to you guys what a weak acid was. Oh, it's an equilibrium, blah, 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 blah. But we didn't know anything about equilibrium. Now you know about equilibrium, okay? Which means this is going to, we call it partially dissociate. That's a weird way to say that. It's not like the hydrogen kind of leaves. It completely leaves, okay? It's just that what we have at equilibrium we have all three species at the same time. Okay? So all three of them exist. This is what we mean by partial dissociation. As soon as this stuff starts forming, as soon as enough of it accumulates, it starts reforming the original acid until all the stuff we were talking about yesterday occurs. What was K for this one? 0.012? which, okay, that's on the intermediate side of things. Would you guys agree? Okay, but it's not too far away from being small. We're going to have to check, see what happens. Once again, my opinion, always find if that negligible, that 5% rule works, because obviously it makes your life incredibly much easier if you don't have to solve directly for X. So what I'm going to do is let you guys take this from there. I think I gave you a concentration of the sulfurous acid, didn't I? Just flat out, here's the molarity of it. Okay, so why don't you guys go to the point where you get to checking the validation of the assumption. This is a good one to practice that on. Guys getting something really similar. Here's the good news. And again, once we get into chapter 16, almost all of your equilibrium problems are going to be just like this one. They're going to be acid or base ones where everything's one-to-one, makes your life incredibly easier. And I'll be honest with you, the majority of them are, if not all of them, are less than 5%. Okay? And on the AP exam, and I hate to say never, okay, because you never know what they're going to do. But so far, I have not seen them have a scenario in which case it was not under 5%. But I'm showing you what to do in case it does. Yes? I picked, again, and this is what I tried to emphasize last time, try to pick X's to say that are negligible, ones that are compared to another quantity. So is this X negligible relative to that? You know what I'm saying? So that leaves us this X to solve for. All right, so obviously we are not within the 5% rule, so what do we do next? How many of you are very comfortable and familiar with the quadratic equation? Ready, set, go. So, I'm sure you guys remember being introduced to this and using this whenever you they always told you solve for both values, right? But they said in real life, one of them is going to make sense and one of them is not going to make sense. This would be real life. One of them is going to make sense and one of them is not going to make sense. So what comes after the x squared? Has anyone gotten that far yet? Plus? Yep. Are you sure it's plus? Mm-hmm. Combining terms. So basically, I took the 0.13. Oh, sorry about that. Where am I? The 0.012. Okay. Multiplied this. I moved this quantity over here. Distributed the 0.012 through. Okay. So the 0.012 times that gives me that. Okay. And then 0.012x equals x squared. Okay. So I get 0.012 equals x squared over 1.5 minus x, right? So to solve for the x squared, okay, basically what I did is took the 0.012 multiplied by 0.15 minus x, distributed through, equals x squared. And so we got 0.018 minus 0.012x equals x squared, and then set everything to zero. So basically I moved these two things over there. So minus 0.018 and plus 0.012x. I'm sorry. I don't know what the other one is. The negative one doesn't make sense because this isn't going to increase. The negative answer doesn't make sense because these can't decrease from zero. And this is not going to, because when you multiply by negative, it's going to, you see what I mean? So, the positive answer is 1. And I believe it came out to 0.128. I got 0.128. Excellent. Now, in that case, we solved, obviously, directly for the x. The x is a dead-on thing, okay? So now all we have to do to find equilibrium positions of everything is plug those in. So now we get 0.128. 0.128, and here's the first time all day, we take the 1.50 and subtract 0.128, and we get something other than the 1.5. Did anyone do that yet? 1.37? Okay. So it wasn't negligible, as we can see. I'm about to possibly teach you some math, something that you didn't know. It's possible. Now, in my last district, for whatever reason, they were covering this technique in one of their math classes. I don't know if you guys are doing this or not. There's a possible faster way without using a quadratic. I don't know what that means. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. It might be that. I just might know it by a different, we might know it by different names. So I'm going to walk you through the process, and you go, oh, yeah, we've done that. Then, okay, then it's whatever you said. Okay? The thing that I'm going to show you is called successive approximations. Have you heard that term? It might be what you guys have learned. I think it's possible. In my last district, it was all the math people were calling it Newton's method. Has that phrase come up?
No.
Okay. Interestingly enough, it's kind of a version of guess and check. However, you start with a really good guess. Okay, because guessing, we could make up any number we wanted to here and say that's the answer and plug it in and get an answer. Okay? But if the answer doesn't make sense, well, we have to do other things. So here's what we're going to do. I just think this is a powerful tool. It becomes really useful when this percentage is not too far over 5%. Okay? Because I see 8.9%, I'm thinking to myself, I'm not doing quadratic. I'm doing successive approximations. You'll see how it works here in a second. We're going to use the information that's up here. Yeah, I'll leave that there for now. And I'm going to erase all this. Here's what we did. We made a very good guess here, wouldn't you say? That was close to what ended up being the right answer. Would you guys agree with that? Okay? So let's use, because it wasn't that far off, so let's use that information. Here's what you would do if you're going to use this idea called successive approximations. You would then retake this value that we ended up with that we know is not right, but we would then put it into wherever we substituted or assumed zero. Because in this problem, we assumed this was zero, right? So we take that value, plug it in to that, solve for x, and see what you get. Well, you guys are going to beat me because my calculator's not working very well. I get, when I do that, 0.128. What I did is I substituted this value that we know is not right, but it's probably pretty close, and so I substituted it in where we made the assumption that something was zero. So now I have I solve for the other x, okay? So when I did that, I got 0.128. Now remember, if we were doing this for the first time, we wouldn't know if this was the right answer, would we? So what you do is you take that value, plug it back into the x, and when you get the same value, the same two times in a row, you're done. Obviously, it was only going to take us two iterations. That was, in this case, quite a bit faster than using the quadratic. Would you guys agree? And for some of us, the quadratic, I'm just kidding. Yeah, I know. Well, that's why you guys have those billion-dollar calculators that has it already in there for you. I know that. I know that. And I actually have to teach all my students all the time. The EE key. Did you know about the EE key?
Yeah.
Do you know where your reciprocal key is?
No.
That's actually the one that's your EE key. If you look on your, doesn't it say X to the negative first as the button, and then above that it says EE?
No.
Yeah. Oh, you have the billion-dollar calculator. You're right. On yours, that's the case, right? Oh, no, yours is a comma. Yeah, you know where it was. Do you ever use that? That's a really useful tool. I'm with you on that. It's kind of like in order before requiring you to use a computer that they actually teach you the keyboard, which I don't think is happening either, is it? Is that a required class, though?
No.
See, there's where I'm going with that. They're requiring you guys all to use these. I know that. All right, so anyway, does everyone get the successive approximations thing? Okay. Well, I'm going to give you guys a whole problem to do on your own. There's a bunch of blank pages on your packet, right? I did that on purpose. Okay, so here we go. Would anyone like to take a stab in the dark as to what the product of this reaction is going to be? And if you say SO4, you're fired. It is SO3. Now, there's some significance behind this, okay? I'm going to go through the significance of this. This is what's going on. These are the precursors to acid rain, okay? In this area of the country, where is most of the acid from our acid rain coming from? Well, you may not know the answer to this, okay? But when you burn coal, much of the coal, believe it or not, a lot of our power that we use is still being coal generated, okay? So when you burn coal, some coal has a high sulfur content. There's a lot of just sulfur in there, okay? Well, when you burn the coal, not only are you producing carbon dioxide from converting the carbon to and burning it with, you know, combining it with oxygen to form carbon dioxide, you're also going to form some sulfur dioxide, which is a gas. When you guys think of the smell of rotten eggs, it's sulfur dioxide gas is what you're smelling, okay? So anyway, sulfur dioxide. That sulfur dioxide then gets up into the atmosphere, can react with oxygen to form sulfur trioxide gas. Okay, now don't write this next thing down unless you want to write it off to the side somewhere. That sulfur trioxide gas is now floating around in the atmosphere. And then one day it rains. Sulfuric acid. There you go. That's where the acid rains. One of the mechanisms for acid rain. Okay, so anyway, there's that. All right, now what's that telling us already? You tell me. There you go. Thank you. What's the K telling us? It's somewhere in the middle. In fact, it's getting pretty close to being, it's much, much further than one of those limits, right? So now, you know, quadratic, successive approximations, you guys are going to have to make the call on that one. All right, so anyway, 0.5. Ooh, watch what I'm doing now. Now, what I think is hilarious is you guys all went, aw, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. That was hilarious. Ready, set, go. What are, the question is, what are the equilibrium concentrations, pressures of all species? The question is, what is the equilibrium pressure of all species?
One.
Ready, set, go. One is not the answer.